Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Mike Langford. I want to welcome you to this talk here tonight. Myself and Bruce Baker and Michael Paulus are part of a project this quarter called Digital Wisdom. And in this project, we brought three speakers to campus to talk about different aspects of theology and technology. And tonight, we're lucky to hear from our third speaker. We'll be hearing from Michael Burdett. Michael Burdett is a postdoctoral research fellow at Wycliffe Hall at Oxford. So we're excited to have him on this side of the pond so we can hear his wisdom. After he gives his talk, then we'll have two responses. The first response will be from Margaret Diddams, who is the director of the Center for Scholarship and Faculty Development here. And then after her, we'll hear from Michael Paulus, who is the university librarian here. So, and then after that, we'll have a brief time for some Q&A. So if you do have some questions, please do hold on to those, because we'll address them with the time we have remaining at the end, okay? So first we'll have Michael come up and give us his talk. So please welcome Michael Burdett.
Well, I just wanted to first say thank you to those who have invited me here to think along with you some wonderful, important, and pressing issues. I think it's no secret that we're living in an increasingly technological world, and to think about how we are meant to be Christian disciples and citizens of the modern world. How are we meant to do that today? So thank you so much to Michael and the rest of his team for inviting me to come in and join in that conversation. And I'm hoping that you yourselves will be involved in that conversation, not only tonight, but perhaps in the future of this initiative itself. Well, the title of the talk that I'm giving today, I've called Forming the Virtual Self, in parentheses, Christian Practice and Internet Living. Is surfing the internet worthy of Christian reflection? And moreover, is it inherently a moral and personally forming act? Well, by these questions, I don't necessarily mean to invoke some staunch and stuffy Victorian sentiment and ethic, as if reflecting on how we are or act on the internet is solely about the content of the websites one does and does not visit. Yes, the kinds of websites that we visit is important to how we lead exemplary and Christ-honoring lives. But the nature, the very nature of our interaction online and the corresponding way it is shaping each of us individually and corporately today is often overlooked. For instance, does the very medium of the internet make more possible things like bullying and trolling, lack of empathy for others, and the crowd mentality? Just think of the mob violence that we saw this last July with Cease of the Lion and Walter Palmer, the dentist whose livelihood was destroyed because of people's reactions online. He's no longer a dentist, really. These extreme examples highlight that our movements and our interactions and our presence on the internet are not morally or personally neutral. In fact, as I'll indicate in just a moment, none of our technological interaction is ever value neutral. In fact, because we're spending more time on the internet today, in fact, I think it's better to, instead of saying that we are spending more time on the internet, we're actually living on the internet, so it's more apt to talk about internet living than just spending time. Because we're spending more time on the internet, we need to begin thinking about how this space is forming us as persons, moral agents, and disciples of Christ. But before I move on, I need to dispel with a common myth regarding technology of any kind, and the kind of underlying anthropology, how we understand what the human being is that's associated with this view of technology. Well, it goes something like this. Technology is value neutral, objects do nothing without human effort. If I want to pick up a hammer and start building a shed, the hammer does nothing more than extend my will, my purpose and intention in building that shed. In other words, technology does nothing to alter the user. It accentuates and amplifies our actions and will, leaving us unaltered in the process. Well, this just isn't true, and it is a pretty poor vision of the human being. Christians and anthropologists alike acknowledge that all of our actions contribute to personal formation, the formation of the person. From the Desert Fathers to people such as John Wesley, the focus on spiritual disciplines, ascetic practices, and personal holiness help us conform to the image and likeness of God in Christ, and they have played substantial roles in showing us the grave importance our practices make to who we are. In other words, our performance, our actions, is entirely relevant for our formation. In the context of technology, our tool use reverberates back onto us and inherently shapes who we are and who we become. Well, I recognize this is a very large topic. So in this talk, I'll focus on one particular area of personal formation that our internet living has drastically changed: our attention. Well, why does attention matter for the Christian life? The great Christian spiritual writer Simone Weil has this to say about attention: absolutely unmixed attention is prayer. What she is getting at here is that a strong inner spiritual life requires sustained and univocal attention. What is more, what we attend to and how we attend to it is who we end up becoming. Well, Miles Davis has said, attention is the limited resource on the internet, not disk capacity, processor speed, or bandwidth. In the rest of our time together, I'll evaluate how our usage of the internet at present has truncated, limited our attention both in cyberspace and when engaging the physical world. Utilizing the philosophical and social scientific work of people like Nicholas Carr and Sherry Turkle, I will argue that many experts have found that focus and attention have degraded in the age of the internet. We bounce from one web page to another, and our devices support and valorize increasing multitasking and shallow interaction with the information presented to us, and indeed to those we meet online. How can we combat this inattention so indicative of our online lives and transform these virtual spaces so that they help support deeper interaction so needed for a meaningful Christian life? I argue here that a deeper infusion of contemplative practices at the core of the Christian spiritual tradition can help reinvigorate a destitute online presence. Spiritual practices such as fasting and Lectio Divina and silence and solitude can all help provide a counter practice to our cyber habits. Indeed, more meditative and attention-rich resources are being utilized through such media as things like the Jesuits Pray As You Go podcast and the online resource called The Work of the People. Rather than solely demonizing our present interaction on the internet as an essential aspect of internet living, Christians can and ought to employ and transform the medium. Well, the first section: is Google making us stupid? Nicholas Carr, a renowned technology journalist, wrote a very controversial article in the July and August 2008 edition of The Atlantic entitled, "Is Google Making Us Stupid? What the Internet is Doing to Our Brains?" Well, the article is met with controversy around the internet and the globe, with many experts and laymen hotly debating its thesis and the evidence on either side. Subsequently, Carr has expanded this article into a book entitled The Shallows: What the Internet is Doing to Our Brains. Carr's thesis in these texts stems first from a personal observation about his own experience while surfing the internet. He says, "I can feel it. Over the past few years, I've had an uncomfortable sense that someone or something has been tinkering with my brain. Remapping the neural circuitry, reprogramming the memory. My mind isn't going, so far as I can tell, but it's changing. I'm not thinking the way I used to. I can feel it most strongly when I'm reading. Immersing myself in a book or a lengthy article used to be easy. My mind would get caught up in the narrative or the turns of the argument, and I'd spend hours strolling through long stretches of prose. That's rarely the case any longer." Well, Carr notices that this increased lack of attention that he has in his own life began when he was beginning to spend more time on the internet. As a journalist, he was amazed, almost bedazzled, at how quickly and easily he could do research for an article he was writing when utilizing the internet. What once took him days going through card catalogs and microfilm and countless hours in the libraries could be done in the comfort of his home or from Antarctica with an internet connection. I am sure we can all relate to how the internet has transformed our work today. But this ease in research comes at an expense for Carr. The medium by which we receive information drastically affects our internal life and the way in which we think. Carr cites the work of media theorist Marshall McLuhan, famous for coining the phrase, "the medium is the message," and asserts media are not just passive channels of information, they supply the stuff of thought, but they also shape the process of thought. The central thesis of Carr's writing is that our attention in our technological era has severely diminished due to increased time on the internet, and that this has led to shallow reading and, indeed, shallow thinking. It is difficult to have a sustained interaction with a text precisely because the form of the internet steers one towards headline reading, emails, and skimming short blogs and essays. Bruce Friedman, a pathologist on the faculty of the University of Michigan, and commentator on how computers affect the field of medicine, notes, "I now have almost totally lost the ability to read and absorb a longish article on the web or in print. I can't read War or Peace anymore. I've lost the ability to do that. Even a blog post of more than 3 or 4 paragraphs is just too much to absorb. I skim it." And as another blog journalist has noted, "I was a lit major in college and used to be a voracious book reader. What happened? What if I do all my reading on the web, not so much because the way I read has changed, i.e. I'm just seeking convenience, but because the way I think has changed?" Well, Carr's thesis isn't by any means original. Indeed, most of his claims are backed by contemporary psychological research, anecdotal evidence aside. He cites a study done by the University College London which tracks the research behavior of people on particular research databases and websites. The study analyzed logged data from the research databases of the British Library, and it discovered that people are indeed using a form of skipping activity where people view just 1 or 2 pages from an academic site and then bounce out, perhaps never to return. The figures are instructive. Around 60% of e-journal users view no more than 3 pages, and a majority, up to 65%, never return to it. While the study's main purpose was to assess the research habits of future scholars, so those that they said were in the Google generation, born after 1993, they also queried other ages as well and noticed the exact same bouncing and skimming trend. This bouncing and skimming activity is indicative of multitasking while on the internet. It is not uncommon to find multiple tabs in an internet browser, which might or not, on the face of it, have anything in common, but which arise from the actual activity of browsing on the internet with flashing banners and the myriad of hyperlinks which lead in many unrelated directions. And this multitasking is rewarded by our businesses and at work. The employee who can juggle multiple jobs and carry a larger workload is rewarded not only with promotion, but yes, even more work. No good work goes unpunished, they say. But we aren't as productive as we think we are when we multitask, according to Stanford psychologist Clifford Nass. Nass's research at Stanford draws specifically on chronic media multitaskers. These are people who might at one time be connected to their BlackBerry, although BlackBerry might be a bit passe. How about their iPhone, their Twitter account, talking to a friend via instant messenger, while watching TV? These are people who are literally living in media. But the most astounding discovery Nass has found is that these people who are chronic multitaskers also think they are very good at it, when in fact, they are terrible. This is what Nass says. Virtually all multitaskers think they're brilliant at multitasking. And one of the big discoveries is, you know what? You're really lousy at it. It turns out multitaskers are terrible at every aspect of multitasking. They get distracted constantly. Their memory is very disorganized. Recent work we've done suggests they're worse at analytical reasoning. We worry that it may be creating people who are unable to think well and clearly. NASA's research suggests that our contemporary trend towards greater multitasking does not yield proportional productivity. There is a law of diminishing returns. And much more disastrous is that this lauded, this praised multitasking is masking our ability for sustained reflection. We forfeit long-term deep thinking for easy, chintzy skimming. But it isn't just our ability to engage deeply with information on the internet that suffers. As Sherry Turkle claims, our relationship with each other have also been affected. Turkle has studied the psychology of human interaction with technology for over 30 years at MIT, including how we relate to sociable robots and to each other through information technologies. In her groundbreaking work, Alone Together, Why We Expect More from Technology and Less from Each Other, Turkle explains that our media-rich environment has altered our interactions with each other, both in those mediums and when interacting outside of them. Turkle has noticed a disturbing trend. Much like the bouncing habits of online surfers found in the University of College London study I just cited, Turkle has observed that many people cycle through their technology where different windows, virtual spaces, and the real world share the attention of the subject. As a bit of an aside, this reminds me, has anybody seen the TV show Portlandia? Maybe that's a bad thing for me to ask in Seattle. But Portlandia, great IFC, independent film channel, television series. Anyway, well, this phenomena of cycling through technology, different windows, virtual spaces, and the real world is actually featured in the very first episode of Portlandia. In it, Fred Armisen's character gets stuck in a technology loop, a hyperbolic version of Turkle cycling through. And he's counseled by his friend to turn to what is called MindFi, a direct connection to these networks without needing to cycle through devices to access them. He no longer needs to keep diverting attention from one object to another object, and instead can rest in what Turkle calls co-presence. Well, unfortunately, by the end of this sketch, his attention is still diverted by advertisements and other distractions, but now they are directly in his mind. The sketch ends with him shutting down, apparently from overuse. Well, the issue, as we have seen already with the multitasking studies, is that when our attention is not sustained, the quality of that attention is seriously reduced. What is worse, Turkle claims, is that cycling through has changed in the past decade into what she calls co-presence. She says, but now with mobile technology, cycling through has accelerated into the mashup of a life mix. Rapid cycling stabilizes into a sense of continual co-presence. Even a simple cell phone brings us into the world of continual partial attention. We are always online now, or at least have the ability to be. As a repercussion, we only devote partial attention to whatever is at hand. And these virtual spaces vie for our attention alongside other physical demands from moment to moment. This shared attention becomes particularly egregious in those instances where human beings, particularly those we love, have to compete for our attention in the physical world alongside our interaction in virtual spaces. This is a common feature of modern virtual life, Turkel notes. She has observed that parents check email as they push strollers. Children and parents text during family dinners. And she even witnessed a runner texting during a marathon in Italy. A bit over the top. Information technology promises to create more time for us to carry out more meaningful tasks, such as being with loved ones, but instead, we have found ways of spending more time with friends and family in which we hardly give them any attention at all. Turkel recounts a particularly sad interview with a child, Audrey. Audrey complains of her mother's inattention when she picks her up at school or after sports practice. At these times, Audrey says, her mother is usually focused on her cell phone, either texting or talking to her friends. Audrey describes the scene. She comes out of the gym, exhausted, carrying her heavy gear. Her mother sits in her beaten-up SUV, immersed in her cell, and doesn't even look up until Audrey opens the car door. Sometimes her mother will make eye contact, but remain engrossed with the phone as they begin the drive home. Audrey says, it gets between us, but it's hopeless. She's not going to give it up. Like, it could have been 4 days since I last spoke to her. Then I sit in the car and wait in silence until she's done. Audrey has a fantasy of her mother waiting for her, expectant, without a phone. I think we can all relate to Audrey, and indeed her mother. We are bedazzled by the ease with which we can look up anything on the internet or communicate to others regardless of physical location and the other activities we have layered in parallel to it. Yet, I think many of us also recognize something has gone awry. We are aware of the ploy of advertising to waylay our attention and the click-me culture that seems to have pervaded our contemporary lifestyles. What is more, our interactions with others have suffered because of it. Our loved ones who are physically before us, there before us, are told they aren't as important as a pithy text from a colleague or the latest BuzzFeed personality quiz. Contemporary practices in our highly technical environment have far-ranging consequences for the stability of human capacities. So much so that the way in which we interact with information and others online drastically affects our attention and ability to think. As we have seen, this has repercussions beyond our interactions through virtual media. It has pervaded and structured our lives outside of it as well. The future of sustained attention really seems to be at stake today. Well, let's turn to the next section on the turn to contemplative practice. Well, I hate to say it, but the church is not inoculated from the prevailing culture in this matter. Despite being urged to turn off their smartphones and tablets when services start, who among us can resist checking the football score, texting a friend, and tweeting about a hilarious moment in a sermon, maybe hashtag fail or something. Not to mention churches that might even encourage such practices during their services. Can we truly listen to a sermon, partake of the Eucharist, or pray without distraction from other media? Our co-presence lives, to use Turkel's phrase, have extended into our sacred spaces, and intentionally or not, are ordering our liturgical and ecclesial movements therein. What can we do as the church to help in this matter? Well, I suggest that there are three Christian practices that are particularly useful in providing a kind of counter practice to our contemporary internet living today. Fasting, Lectio Divina, and silence and solitude. All three are discrete practices that have enjoyed a long-standing history within the Christian contemplative tradition. Each will be taken in turn, and with each, I'll unpack how the discipline is useful in assuaging the drawbacks of current internet behavior. So let's turn to fasting first. Well, fasting of any kind is about the removal of some consistent element in one's life that is repeated often so that one's life might be intentionally ordered anew. Historically, it is generally associated with food, where one abstains from some food or eating altogether for a set period of time. We see examples of fasting in the biblical witness, where Moses fasts for 40 days whilst receiving the Decalogue, and Christ's temptation in the desert is coterminous with a 40-day fast as well. Indeed, it has been a common feature of Christian ascetic spirituality since the early church. The significance of fasting is in the recognition it brings towards our embodied desires. With the removal of a regular feature of one's life, such as food, there is an acknowledgement of physical dependency on the things of this world and on our ultimate dependence on God. In removing something from our lives, we are reminded that inasmuch as we depend upon creation for our every moment, God is the originator and sustainer of each moment. Furthermore, fasting does not deny our desires or negate them. No. Rather, it acknowledges and manifests how we are motivated by them. We must desire. We must use. We must consume to stay alive. However, fasting makes us aware of this desiring, this using, and this consuming, and gives us a new attachment and awareness that are often overlooked, particularly in our contemporary materialistic and consumeristic society. As Bill Kavanaugh so poignantly remarks, although consumerism is often equated with greed, which is an inordinate attachment to material things, consumerism is in fact characterized by detachment from production, producers, and products. In an odd way, not allowing a desire to be satiated actually gifts us with greater attachment to the things of this world and focuses our attention and awareness of our demeanor and our comportment towards them. In this acknowledgement of the role that desire plays in our everyday lives, however, fasting also reorients those desires. As the great Anglican theologian Rowan Williams has said, the history of Christian spirituality indicates that the tradition insists that the conversion of desire lies at the center of the Christian life. In removing something from our everyday lives, it allows an opening for this desire that would be placed on the things of the world to instead be placed on Christ and on God. The time normally set aside for engaging in the activity, i.e. eating, becomes reoriented through our spiritual disciplines, such as meditation, reflection, and prayer. It is where chronos, the idea of everyday kind of time, turns to kairos, God's time. And indeed, it's a reminder that chronos only finds meaning amidst the more basic kairos. It operates according to a space, it operates according to the new creation and manifests the kingdom here that is to come. Fasting can help refocus our demeanor to the world largely shaped by the internet today. In fasting, we are taken from practices inundated by internet consumption that have us detached from the world around us, and instead are made aware that we have embodied desires that are to be directed toward God. As we clear a space cluttered by constant multitasking and erratic bouncing, we find serenity and grounding because we focus on our ultimate origin and end in God's kingdom. Let's turn to the second practice, that of Lectio Divina. Well, Lectio Divina has enjoyed a newfound resurgence in the past few decades and has been a seminal spiritual exercise of monastic life throughout the centuries. Lectio Divina literally means divine reading. It is different from the sort of reading we do to obtain information. Rather, it is a technique of prayer and a guide to living. It is a means of descending to the level of the heart and of finding God. On the whole, it is radically different from how we approach texts today. And this is precisely why it is beneficial. Instead of garnering the basic information in a text or even approaching it with a critical eye, we are called to sit with it and to listen. Lectio Divina means a close, prayerful openness to the text so that one both reads the text and in patient expectation is open to the text speaking back to the person. It is a practice of slow and deep reading that allows for extensive spiritual engagement with God through this encounter with the text. Well, Gigo II, a medieval Carthusian monk, instituted a ladder of prayer that has popularized a fourfold approach to Lectio Divina and has been a common guide throughout the ages. Before turning to the text to be read during Lectio Divina, it is a common practice to clear both outer and inner space of distraction so that engagement with the text before us can be singular and undisturbed. So the first step charged to its practitioners is to read the text, lectio, read. Then they are to reflect, meditation, on the text, and to think about its significance. This should then give way to prayer, oratio, and finally to the gift of quiet stillness and contemplation. The movements are not meant to be mechanical or done by obligation or imperative, which might lead to a deteriorated focus and attention on the words that are read. Rather, an acute sensitivity is precisely the outcome and aim of the practice, a sensitivity to God's presence and teaching through the Holy Spirit. It is clear that the Christian practice of Lectio Divina has significant import into our modern internet-shaped lives. As seen in the last section, our reading habits have been disastrously transformed in the age of the internet. We skim through what we read and only have a nominal and marginal, mild engagement with it. We only attend to words in as much as they give up their information to us, the information that we desire to exploit from them. Lectio Divina, however, provides a counter practice to being with words and the presence that they are meant to convey. In Lectio Divina, we recognize the inherent sacred, real presence of the text, the author, and ourselves. Lectio gives a tender patience that waits on the one who speaks through those moments of quiet attendance to his holy word. When doing so, it transforms our relations to the rest of the world and to other words which might not, on the face of it, seem sacred at all. The gain of faculty towards sacred texts during Lectio Divina is a gain to our reading and approach in other contexts as well. So what we do in Lectio Divina affects the way that we read other things as well. In fact, I was just talking earlier this afternoon about how poetry and the reading of poetry is very akin, I think, to this idea of slow reading, so to speak. The way that we sit with these words is very different from the way you might read a headline in a BuzzFeed top 10 list. Well, the final Christian practice that can aid us here is silence and solitude. Well, silence and solitude belong together as a contemplative practice. Silence without solitude is stillborn. Solitude without silence is solipsistic. They are both the preconditions to the stillness spoken of in Psalms 46:10. Be still and know that I am God. They are the ballast and foundation of other Christian practices and augment and strengthen them altogether. Indeed, we see this with those practices already discussed. For instance, Christ sets this example when he fasts for 40 days and is alone in the desert during his temptation. And Lectio Divina depends upon retreating to a location that is quiet, where one is called to silence the incessant inner chatter that will distract one from a focused and attentive demeanor. Silence and solitude are at the heart of any contemplative life. Well, silence and solitude do not negate or diminish the need for relation or community. So in removing oneself from society briefly does not mean that it diminishes our need or our relation to that community. They do not stand in opposition to being with others. Rather, it helps cultivate more meaningful and healthy relationships. As Lawrence Cunningham puts it, without solitude, one runs the risk of conformism, unhealthy dependencies, and a failure to discover and to respond to one's gifts, group illusions, mechanical relationships, an absence of mystery, and much more. Absolute definition and deference to a community has us lose out on the specificity of our individual lives. And in the modern age, we are in danger of succumbing to the power of the crowd. As the great Danish Christian philosopher Kierkegaard has borne witness, the crowd is untruth. When lost in the sea of innumerable faces of personalism, when lost in the sea of innumerable faces, the personalism so direly needed to live an authentic life is stripped completely. We lose ourselves in it. The Christian spiritual practices of solitude and silence ask us to step outside of our social networks to be confronted anew as a singular individual before God. Yet it does not lead to an overall schism, a separation ultimately from society, a complete and ultimate retreat from it. Ironically, solitude and silence lead us back into relation and enable us to serve them better. As Thomas Merton has said, it is in deep solitude that I find the gentleness with which I can truly love my brothers. The more solitary I am, the more affection I have for them. Solitude and silence teach me to love my brothers for what they are, not for what they say. So on the whole, solitude and silence help us to attune and attend to the world in more productive ways. Instead of projecting into the world and getting caught up in the demands of social life, we are called in silence and solitude to a slower rhythm, where we might attend to the practice of presence. In those moments, we become still and we wait on God. We wait for His illumination in our lives and bearing in the present. We are silent before a world where rocks really do cry out and God speaks through the still, small voice. We can only hear this if we're still and silent. We can only perceive this when we are alone, for the cacophony of modern public life crushes God's presence, which springs from the fragility of the overlooked. Solitude and silence may be the most difficult of the spiritual practices considered, for we are constantly surrounded by others who make demands upon us, and a world that is increasingly in our personal space. Retreating from social life entirely and seeking stillness is incredibly rare today, but this is precisely why it is needed. In the age of the internet, where we lead co-presence lives and are always on, we are rarely disconnected from the networks that give us access to an infinite amount of information and other people. We really can't be alone. Even in those occasions which are supposed to signal a break from our everyday lives, as we have with going on vacations, you're meant to remove yourself from your work, we have increasing difficulty separating ourselves entirely and are often still connected virtually. But in order to be more effective to others and to lead more healthy Christian lives, solitude and silence can help us reinvigorate an atrophied attunement to ourselves, the world, and to God. Conclusion: transfiguring virtual spaces. Well, the meditative tradition can provide substantial resources in helping to alleviate the vapid and inattentive posture to our environments indicative of contemporary internet living. In each of these three long-standing Christian disciplines, we are called to a deeper engagement with God and the rest of the world. When our movements in the physical world are habituated by these disciplines, we become more intentional and pronounced. Our physical and indeed our virtual interactions become more reflective and attentive. We find we read more deeply, and our connections with others become more meaningful and robust. Our erratic lives gives way to real shalom. Let me be clear. I am not intentionally arguing that online spaces inherently and deterministically create the kind of online habits that we actually see today. I don't adhere to what is called hard technological determinism. I do think we can operate differently in the world and in these mediums. The phrasing counter-practice does acknowledge that the contemplative practices outlined here do run opposite to our current internet practices. They are at odds today. However, encountering these practices, it can lead to a transformation of that space. They are not at base inherently antagonistic. The internet is not essentially reprobate. In fact, we get a glimpse of what this transformation of virtual spaces might look like in the case of two examples in closing. The first example is produced by the Jesuit Media Initiatives. It's a very spiritually enriching podcast called Praise You Go. Every day, they offer a 10 to 15 minute downloadable audio file you can put on your iPod or your computer that offers a framework for contemplative prayer. It begins with an acknowledgement of the day in the liturgical calendar, thus claiming the space for kairos, that this is attunement, that God is here, that this world is God's. Whereupon the listener is called into a sacred liturgical moment with the sounds of church bells. Then a silent and centering demeanor is called for while sacred music plays for several minutes that culminates in a reading from scripture. Reflective questions are then posed, and the listener meditates on the scripture and questions. The scripture is read again. It's very similar, actually, to Lectio Divina. And final thoughts and questions are given. Finally, the podcast ends with the doxology. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. And as this is said, with each clause, more voices are added in unison to the group. It is a truly significant instance of transformative Christian practice, where one is made aware that others around the world are themselves partaking along with you in this moment that is set apart and redeemed in this virtual space. We find something similar in the website, The Work of the People. This has kind of been around for 2 to 3, 4 years, something like that. The creators of this multimedia-rich website specialize in offering what they call visual liturgy, recognizing that what they produce is not intended for entertainment or a utilitarian tool. Instead, the aim is to be, quote, a prophetic witness that embeds us in our humanity and activates our imagination for a world that doesn't yet exist, but which we have been called to co-create. God's alternate upside-down world of abundance and freedom, love, and grace. One can view a plethora of videos as the medium to participate in this visual liturgy. They have resources for the entire liturgical calendar, and each piece of visual liturgy weaves together thoughts from eminent Christian spiritual leaders, scriptural texts, and meditative still images, video, music, etc. It really does utilize the full medium, I think, of that the information rich resource on the internet can provide. It is self-aware in its proclamation that virtual spaces can serve as a sacred place to meet God, and that it has a prophetic role within the internet. Well, I see in these examples, I see Christians taking virtual space and transfiguring it for the kingdom. Just as mere grain and grapes are transformed into the body and blood of Christ, signaling that they have been sacralized by and for God, so these virtual spaces become the place of God's condescension, God's presence. They are real localities of God's sacred presence, and they take seriously the witness of God and the health of the church online. We would do well to heed their example, to begin participating with them and others like it in creating that we have the opportunity to transform these new places that can in turn be moments within the kingdom of God. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Burdett, for a wonderfully insightful theological diagnosis and challenging prescription of spiritual counterparts. So first we'll hear from Margaret Diddams and then from Michael Paulus in response. So, Dr. Diddams.
Well, welcome. Thank you all for coming out. As Dr. Langford noted, I am the director for the Center for Scholarship and Faculty Development. I have lots of titles that are here. I won't spend all night going over them. I'm also the director of SPU SERF program, which is Spiritual and Educational Resources for Vocational Exploration. And the SERF program, in part, is sponsoring tonight. And why that's important for you to know is because when we think of vocation writ large, it's about how we choose to use our life and how to live our lives. And it's just totally in line with what you were talking about tonight. To paraphrase, so a part, another title I have here is Professor of Industrial Organizational Psychology. And so I want to talk with you, my comments are reflective on the social nature of people, especially the social nature of people at work. As Dr. Burnett talked about, to paraphrase Nicholas Carr, is the internet making us more stupid? I would like to ask the question, is the internet making us less loved or less likely to love? A little background, I worked at Microsoft from 1994 to 1999. There were two reasons I left before the fall of the stock. That didn't go over well. If you were around, two things in my life that was happening is that my time at Microsoft, the flexibility of anywhere, anytime became everywhere and all the time. And this was before smartphones. So there was just this pressure, social and economic, to be constantly working. And if it wasn't working with your laptop, it was in your head. And it got to the point where my kids were saying, Mommy, you're not listening. So in a way, it was, I didn't have a smartphone in my hand, but work was always in my head. The other aspect of it is that working at Microsoft in the 1990s was kind of hot stuff. It's like Amazon today. And I realized that I was losing my sense of identity being fully grounded in Christ. The last thing is, because work was always in my head, when I would go to church and sit, physically sit, my head could not be quiet. It was like I had slammed on the brakes and I went forward. And some of you maybe have that experience. You're so busy, you're so busy, so busy, you sit down and you cannot quiet yourself because your head is still going. And so for all these issues, I left Microsoft in 1999. And what led me to be able to go is, this is important, so please don't leave as people dribble out, is someone gave me Henri Nouwen's book, Beloved. And I realized that in my techno-filled world, I had forgotten that I was God's beloved, and that I needed to reclaim that, and that I needed to practice spiritual gifts in order to remain grounded, that my primary identity was beloved in Christ. So what makes us beloved, in a sense? What makes us human? Well, you all have been told your entire lives, probably from you remember, the importance of high self-esteem. It's important to have high self-esteem. But what we have realized in the last couple of years is that what we call non-contingent self-esteem, that means self-esteem just not based on anything, is actually fairly fragile and risk-averse. And so people who have high and fragile self-esteem, they act out more, they get angrier than others. Our self-esteem has to be grounded in something. And if it's not grounded in beloved, I'm going to put forward to you, it's grounded in busyness. You're either beloved or busy. Benjamin Franklin said, never confuse motion with action. I have iPads, I have cell phones and everything else that Robin Reedy will buy me. Back there. But what happens is this busyness, we're not really doing anything in the busyness. So I will have students do PowerPoint presentations that have every bell and whistle and every aspect in it, and they're fairly shallow in the meat and heart of the presentation. And what's happened is those students have put in as much time as I would expect in a presentation, but they focus on the easy stuff and not the hard stuff. And so I think our engagement with the internet and that busyness, if I'm busy, I'm therefore important, that busyness is at a fairly shallow level. And so we forget how to do the deep thinking. Henry Nouwen was a famous theologian, a well-respected writer, and later in his life, he gave it all away to take care of a very mentally and physically disabled young man named Adam, which is the title of one of his final books that he wrote about in taking care of Adam. Philip Yancey, in an interview with Nouwen, said Nouwen felt two voices competed inside of him. One urged him to succeed and achieve. The other called him simply to rest in the comfort that he was beloved by God. I wanted to say that I believe the internet and our attached life urges us to succeed and achieve, to get more done, to be more productive. And we are fast losing the ability to rest in the comfort of being beloved in God. And so silence and solitude becomes very important so that when we sit, we can be present. I just want to read to you Philippians 2, 5 through 7. Let the same mind be in you, the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself. I want to suggest to you that silence and solitude, lectio divina, and fasting are ways that we can empty the busyness out of ourselves to create space to become beloved. And when we seek to become beloved, then we need to seek to be beloved with each other. And when we talk about identity, we need to talk about social identity. The theologian John McMurray wrote that it is only in relation to others that we exist as persons. We live and move and have our being not in ourselves, but in one another. And so the body of Christ is how we understand, how we understand who we are as individuals. McMurray goes on to talk about society versus community. McMurray defined community as a group of persons in relation, directly related by love, and not commercial transaction. The essayist and novelist poet Wendell Berry best captures this nature of community in his series of novels about the fictional townspeople in rural Kentucky who are part of the Port William membership. A group of people connected by time and place, but not always familial bonds. His character, Hannah Coulter, describes the membership in this way. There was no bookkeeping, no accounting, no settling up. What you owed was considered paid when you had done what needed doing. Every account was paid in full by the understanding that when we were needed, we would go, and when we had need, the others or enough of them would come. I want to suggest that what Dr. Burnett was talking about, this emptiness, these empty relationships, the being on our phones, mine's a six, so it's a little weird, is that we've lost the practice of being wholly present to each other. This issue goes back to the 1920s. You can see it in Martin Buber's writing and talk when he writes about I and thou and being wholly present to each other. We've lost the ability to be wholly present to each other because of our blindness to busyness. And so if I could say anything tonight about what you hear, we need to live a pace. peace-filled life. That shalom is not only peace-filled, but it's pace-filled. Because we need to be able to be present for each other. We need to be able to hold silence and solitude. Without being wholly present to each other, there's some bad things that can happen. I want to end with a couple of these. First is that invisibility, to not be loved. A lot of the past 2 weeks have been in the news, campus riots, campus uprising, campus angst. And a lot of that angst is from students who feel unseen. And I'm not criticizing whether they are or not. I think they generally feel that they are unseen. But we have to ask about what is it in our milieu that allows for people to feel so unseen around that. How many of you have heard of ghosting? Ghosting is the practice of disappearing online, as it were, without consequence. Again, if we're not practicing I-thou relationships, ghosting makes sense. Just using people and disappearing. And at the very worst part, there's de-individuation, which you talked about in mob scenes, is that when I do not have a sense of self, when I feel invisible, when my sense of self is totally divorced from my social self, I can do really terrible things. And so for the body of Christ, we simply must be practicing I-thou relationships. We must practice being in the body of Christ, and we must practice being beloved within the body of Christ. So as Dr. Burnett says, it's the internet, how we use the internet, we need to be reflective, and we also need to think about what are the other practices in our life that balance it out in order to have that peace-filled life. That's my comments. Thank you.
Thank you, Margaret. Thank you, Michael. So for this lecture series, we've been using the term digital wisdom. This terminology originally comes from educational consultant Mark Prinsky, who popularized the terms digital natives and digital immigrants in the early 20th century. And we use these terms to distinguish differences, different generational experiences of technology. Those who've grown up with technology versus those who have adapted to it later in life. But what is increasingly more important now are differential abilities. This is a distinction or digital divide that has more to do with the use of new technologies rather than just access to them, which is still an issue for many. But Prinsky says there now is a need for digital wisdom, which he describes as a twofold concept, referring in the first sense to wisdom in the use of technology to enhance our innate capabilities. But in a second sense, this refers to wisdom arising from the use of digital technology to access cognitive power beyond our usual capacity. Prinsky's twofold concept challenges us to think about the wise use of technology or technological competencies, but also to think about how technology itself can be a means for us to become wiser individually, communally, and culturally. I appreciate Dr. Burnett's attention to tension. The technology writer and others, Howard Rheingold and others, have described that this is the most important digital literacy or discipline. We need to understand how our brains pay attention, how we organize reflectively information into a narrative network to put things together, and how we encounter information and through a direct experience network and actually incorporate new information into our minds. But attention is more than these cognitive operations. And advocates of technological mindfulness or attentiveness emphasize the importance of being more attentive to our whole selves and our embodiment in the physical world. And there's also a theological dimension to attention. As Simone Weil said, attention involves opening up oneself to receive the love of God and the capacity to love others. I also appreciate Dr. Burdett's direction of our intentions toward integration. It challenges of digital life are not answered by avoiding it, but by seeking to transform it. To avoid new technologies is neither practical nor desirable. As with electricity, personal computers, and email, technologies such as the internet, mobile devices, and social media are becoming integral parts of our shared human experience. Creating a digitally dualistic view of offline and online reality and life is dangerous. We see the dangers of digital dualism in numerous studies that show a lack of proactive ethics online, as well as moral disconnects between online and offline behavior. We talked about some examples tonight. The contemplative practices that Dr. Burdett suggests, which cause us to reflect on and become grounded in the greatest realities, do have the power to improve our online lives and environments. These strike me as wise uses of technology, which should help us become wiser people. But I wonder, Michael, if you could help us go a bit further, stretching your technological and theological imagination, to help us consider how new technologies themselves might make us wiser. Throughout the history of the church, from Hugh of St. Victor through Francis Bacon, there have been Christian thinkers who have affirmed that technology is part of the spiritual task of reversing the effects of the fall and participating in the new creation. This positive view of technology has had a long and transformative impact on the history of technology, especially on the development of communication technologies and practices. Paul innovatively used letters to connect the early Christian community. Origen and others created a new type of book, the bound codex, to improve access to biblical texts through better collection, organization, presentation, and portability. Augustine and others transformed the practice of reading to connect it with personal formation and transformation. And reform movements such as Protestantism, Calvinism, and Methodism led to the formation of a comprehensive print culture of personal Bibles, and devotionals, pew hymnals, Sunday school curricula, and extensive self-help literature that shaped and sustained Christian communities. Into the communications and communities into the present. Now, digital communication and connectivity is changing the way we create and engage with texts individually and socially, mixing old practices with new. For example, the Bible is increasingly experienced as an app rather than a codex. And when I assign my students biblical texts, many of them choose to listen to them. And Michael pointed to two online platforms that privilege audio, visual forms of communication. And as we begin to see new digital forms and networks, such as networked books, structured like Wikipedia, and computational ways of reading, which automatically extract meaning from texts, one wonders what new digital practices might emerge. What profound transformations of the digital environment, textual or social, might make us wiser than we would have been without them. Or to put it another way, what would a modern day Paul, Augustine, or John Wesley do with the internet? Thank you.
So we have time for a few questions. If anybody has any questions for... would you like? If we have any... questions for any of them, you can do that.
Yeah, great. Yeah, well, Michael, what do you think? What would Paul do with the internet?
Actually, I was hoping Michael could answer that question.
I didn't want to. Yeah, there you go.
Is this where I can say I'm not my brother's keeper? I think, as Michael has rightly pointed out, that so much of Christian history, I mean, the greats of Christian history have actively utilized the present resources of the current day to better convey the gospel and the new media that they had available to them. And I think of somebody like Thomas Aquinas, who was like, oh, let's, you know, this is great. We've got Aristotle here that can make sense of so many wonderful things. A great synthesizer. So I think a reactionary response to technology seems to me to actually defy a very strong current in the Christian tradition, as Michael has intimated. And even to see how it has cultivated and even led to important new insights about what we might think of the reality of God in our midst, so to speak, whether that's through a greater awareness of something in the text itself, you know, bringing something together in the codex, you know, you'll have greater playing off one particular letter from another, even just the idea of the way of canon developed because of codex when it comes down to it. All these things have different kinds of pressures. I think what is the most exciting about new information technologies is the way it can weave together so many different types of sensorial inputs. It can be so multimedia rich that it's not just audio, it's not just visual, it's not just words, it can be images. And what I think is great about something like the internet, as opposed to, let's say, something like television, is how interactive it can be. So perhaps there is a possible benefit, I think an advancement, at least in the last kind of 20 or 30 years, and the kind of creativity, I think that could be inherent in that as well, the kind of input one can have into itself. What would Paul do? Boy, Paul or Augustine? I don't know, do you have any thoughts?
Oh no, I think we can do research a lot quicker.
Yeah, absolutely.
I have to say that I found your talk ending up in a different place than I thought you were beginning your talk. And that confused me a little bit, because when you began, you started talking about it's not like a hammer, a tool. You cited Carr, you cited McLuhan, all of whom say that there's something, McLuhan, the medium is the message. The actual technology that you use is shaping you. And yet by the end, you are saying, it's not the actual technology itself, it's what we do with the technology. So that it does seem to become a tool. And some of the examples you were giving earlier, I'm intrigued by the example about the researchers that only look at a couple of pages from the British Library. Well, those of us who started doing research way before the internet, we also only looked at a couple of pages. I mean, you learn to skim judiciously to find out the material you want. So it seems to me that there's a real importance of genre involved, and that the genre is not necessarily affected by the medium. And so when we begin, and you also mentioned poetry and Lectio Divina, well, that's a genre. It's and you can do Lectio Divina online, you can do poetry online, but that's different than taking a BuzzFeed personality quiz. But that's a genre difference. So what I'm wondering about is, what is it specifically you think about the medium that encourages lack of attention, multitasking, looking at people not as beloved, but... So does that mean...
I think it's both and. I think that we need to dispel the myth that our interaction with any technology leaves us completely unchanged. And I think that's really important to talk about. But there's also the kind of social and cultural embeddedness of that technology, that there's a certain amount of flexibility that we can potentially have with a kind of thing. So it might be a kind of range of parameters that a technology might have. So, for instance, picking up the hammer, I might use it to build a shed, or I might use it to, make an armoire, or I might use it to kill somebody, right? Now, it still makes me a user of the hammer, but I think it's probably more a range of possibilities that affects who you are, and the way in which you employ that particular tool, either as an instrument of killing, or as an instrument of creation.
it's not univocal, I think is what I'm trying to say, but it does still make you a user of a tool, if that makes sense.
But the tool itself doesn't matter.
Perhaps if it's more ergonomic, I'm trying to think that there are certain things that, no, I mean, it's...
Is it Carr's argument that it's the actual tool itself that's changing our brain?
I think he's saying something less than that, which is the way in which we're using this tool at present, the way in which we somehow created websites, right, that have huge headlines in the beginning, a little paragraph, lots of advertisements, really visually stimulating, that makes it difficult for us to go through it. So yes, but is it just the fact that there are these virtual places we can go to and what we do with them? No, because it's, I think it's more pluriform, these kind of online spaces. So that's what I'm saying, that what the internet can offer us is much more pluralistic than the way we've shaped it into these particular kinds of avenues. So the medium is the message in its current permutation, because this is the way we've created, this is the way we've used it, it's the way we've socially, we socialized into the way of using it, which is a kind of play back and forth, right, between, well, this is what we expect from a website, therefore, the people that then create them do that because that's the expectation.
The question is, have we created the internet in our own image? And as you just said, how are we using it? And creatures who are saved but not redeemed, you see the very worst of the very, and you know, pornography and pray as you go. They're both on the internet. What John Bartsch, who's a social psychologist at Yale, would say is that we use the internet in the way that reflects our own values. And so whatever values we have, we tend to use the internet in a way that reflects on our values. So our behaviors on the internet shape our values shape our use on the internet. And so, it's not neutral, the internet's not neutral, but it's a tool to serve who we are. And that's what I was trying to say is, I could ignore my kids prior to iPhone 6, or I could use iPhone 6 to ignore my kids, but if I have a predilection to be in my head and not have those beloved, holy, present relationships, I can use the internet to do that, or I would do it without the internet. It doesn't matter, it just gives me a tool to be who I am. And that's what I think, as Christians, we need to dig deeper into that, again, that social identity and how the internet is shaping or not shaping the practice of social identity.
And the internet isn't this static, concrete, right, defined thing. I mean, the internet has evolved over time and has gone through different stages, you know, from 1.0, 2.0, now looking at 3.0. And so with any new technology, going back to Doug's question, you know, you begin to experiment with what you can do with this new space. And the first thing you do is you take what you're currently doing and sort of move it into this new environment, this new tool. So if you go back and look at the first printed books, they were printed, font, page setting, and all that, to look like manuscripts, you know, handmade books. And over time, 100 years or so, they started playing with, you know, the types, and they started to play with the presentation of the text, and then begin to do new things with what a printed book ended up looking like and what you could do with the new technology. So the web moving from this 2.0 and now 3.0, which 2.0 being more of a dynamic interactive web, does really give you a lot more agency in terms of what you can do with this platform. And 3.0, which has more to do with Internet of Things or linking it, integrating more with the real world and establishing kind of authoritative identities and such, is really going to change how we think about authority, how we think about the relationships between things and ourselves. And so, I mean, the long way of saying that the internet is sort of this dynamic thing that we are shaping, that we're going to shape too.
That's what I mean, is it shaping us, or are we
are we shaping it? And is it equally reciprocal?
And that's where attention can be very helpful in terms of making sure that we are paying attention to what this thing is that we're involved.
Other questions? So I had dinner with Michael Paulus last week, and we were talking about whether or not the 45-minute didactic sermon is still relevant, given that people have such short attention spans now. And we were talking about should the church respond and change the way we do preaching. So I was thinking about that conversation during this lecture tonight, especially on the lines of, is Google making us stupid, and you know, we have short attention spans. And so I'm curious, from all three of you, I'm curious your thoughts on this. I really like Dr. Burdett's practices of fasting and must do the Camino and silence and solitude. What strikes me is individual reforms, as ways the individual can kind of, what you call them, like counter practices. So should the church as a whole, should we like double down on the 45-minute sermon and just say, you know, come hell or high water, this is the way to go, and sort of do a counter-resistance as a church as a whole, when like there's been this, I think, a fundamental shift in our literacy practices, and should the church respond to the changing needs of the congregation? The congregation reads differently now. So should we still be preaching the 45-minute sermon?
Can I say two things? First of all, as a psychologist and social scientist, when I read Sherry Turkle's work, this is sort of what Dr. Van Zandt was saying, it's not longitudinal, and it's not cross-panel, so we really can't say if people had these tools 45 years ago dumped on them, would they act any different than today? We really need longitudinal and cross-panel studies to say it is something uniquely different. That said, because I'm a little bit older than you, who ever liked 45-minute sermons?
With a narrative.
Yes, I think that's really big. We were talking earlier this afternoon about how you're getting this shift in certain kinds of television, you know, from the 80s, you know, the height of the sitcom, to more long-form serialization television, or even things like, particularly with kind of podcasts, things like that, where you're getting kind of long-form narratival. I mean, we're talking about things like This American Life, Radiolab, Serial. I mean, these are all things that, like, sure, it can be 45 minutes, but, I mean, if it's gonna be, like, dogmatic 45 minutes, like, no one's gonna like that ever. But if it's something that you can weave together different approaches to the words themselves, the way in which you convey things through narrative, story, pitch, rhythm, then you're inherently making that message more pluriform. And in what we're primed for stories when it comes to, you know, down to it.
I also want to add that when you have for the 45-minute sermon, you make the sermon the focus of the service. And I'm just putting a brother in enough to want the Eucharist to be the center of the service and for the ecclesia, the church. So at what cost are relationships to the 45-minute sermon? At what cost is the Eucharist to the 45-minute sermon? So I'm good with the primacy of it. unless it's our home.
So what was it you told him?
Well,
yeah.
I've got my pastor in the room, so.
I would love 45 minutes of preaching.
Talking about 25. Well, I think it's, you know, it's interesting, you know, why, where did the 45 minutes or 25 minutes or where did that come from? You know, how did that form establish itself as the way to preach, and what's changed since then? So if the analog is the classroom, you know, we still have faculty who give sort of run it, talks, lectures. You know, there's a place for that at certain times, but increasingly we're looking more at more active learning models. And so we have much more participation between students and faculty. And so if it's, you know, in a certain way, the long sermon, it actually used to be longer than 45 minutes, was the most efficient way of distributing information, then that made sense. Is that the case now? I mean, are there more effective ways of engaging people around the topics that are brought up in the sermon?
So, some related questions, and maybe just some random thoughts. So, as you brought up the podcast thing, a question related to that. So, I listen to Serial and This American Life and all those, right? But I do that because I'm driving to work, and so I'm doing something else. Whereas when I think of a sermon for 45 minutes, I have to sit there, and if I take out my phone, even if I'm taking notes or reading scripture on my phone, people think I'm doing something that I shouldn't be doing, right? So sometimes what I wonder is this idea of, I know we don't multitask, we can monotask and switch very quickly. Can we use distraction in a sense to enable us to do things that we hadn't been able to do before? So what benefit do I have sitting, listening to a pastor give a sermon for 45 minutes in a church versus listening to him give that same 45-minute sermon on a podcast? And then, so I mean, that's kind of maybe my first question, like is me driving or doing something else detrimental to what I'm listening to? However, I know most of the Serial story, so I was pretty addicted to that. But then my second question is this idea of kind of interruption and distraction that digital technologies give us, such as iMessaging or instant messaging. So I don't think we're going to get rid of that type of messaging. I think it's going to continue to expand. We, you know, email is kind of going away, and companies like Slack are overvalued essentially in terms of how much they're worth and how much they're used in the business place. So how might I, as a Christian and somebody that wants to continue kind of Henry Nouwen's way of sharing that belovedness of Christ with others, be fully present in that iMessage, which is a short conversation, but also fully present here? Is that possible without me leaving the room to respond to the iMessage, or not answering my phone at all? So like, how do we negotiate that? And is it an either or, is it a both and? And kind of how might we be able to use these technologies to a point where they don't become too much, I guess? If that makes sense. So they're kind of related, but.
I can answer the second one. So I think that the real detriment is partial presence or partial attention. So yeah, I think it is preferable to say, I'm going to turn off my phone because I'm going to have a conversation. And when I'm done with this, if I have some time, I'm somewhere else, I can attend to this and devote my full attention to that. Now that's not an easy thing, I think, to do necessarily, but you know, there are things one can do. Turning off, you know, your phone so it doesn't actually ding. You know, so that, you know, when you're in a place, in a space, you can pick up and say, look, it, you know, I've had 8 people who have contacted me. Rather than constantly having to think, oh, should I move on from this conversation now? Is there something better I should be looking at? Because, I mean, it's also motivation, things like that. People tend to start thinking, well, I'm going to pull out my phone because I think I'm bored here, you know? And I don't want to discourage. I have something more pressing. And I think it's that decision, that ethical decision, that seems to me to be the saddest part about it. Even if you're not doing it in any conscious way, definitely doing it unconsciously. It's that those unconscious decisions, I think, that are sometimes some of the scariest. So I'll answer the second question.
I just want to reflect on when you meet someone you know not really well and you say, how are you doing? The common response is, oh, I'm so busy. And my concern to your question is,
we're using busyness as a moniker of importance. And so by pulling out my phone because I'm bored, this tells me, this reinforces I'm busy, ergo I'm important. Because of my bored, I'm not so important.
But just to clarify, I didn't use the word busyness, and I didn't use the word bored. So that's what I'm wondering is, I mean, there are times where I'm bored, and whether or not I had a phone in my pocket, I'm still going to be bored. So is there ever a time where you can ethically say, yeah, I do need to take care of this because it's my wife and I need to attend to this?
Absolutely.
And so negotiate that. So I think, can we help others develop skills, negotiate that in a good, healthy way?
Yeah.
Or do we say, no, that's never, aside from emergencies, that's not appropriate? I mean, that's, so not so much the busyness or the bored part, but really, because I think as we move forward into this culture, we have to wrestle with that because it's not going to go away. The answer isn't, I would argue, the answer is not always going to be turn it off.
Yep.
So we have to learn to negotiate in a healthy way without turning it off. And maybe part of that is setting expectations for the other, too.
Well, and the game there, right, with mobile technology is you can have access to, wait, you know, someone's in real danger, whereas before I couldn't. But the sacrifice for that then becomes partial attention. So it's what is gained by it, but also what is sacrificed. And I think it's how then do you compute, you know, under what kind of calculus do you decide whether one, yeah, how you balance, I think, both of those kind of commitments.
Well, a lot of our services and technology are really about filters. I mean,
yeah.
we're overwhelmed with the illusion of being sort of omniscient and omnipresent, but the reality is we're limited beings and we can only handle so much. And you know, as we have it in previous periods of time, you know, we encounter new technology, we have access to information, and we have to develop filters. We have to develop tools for managing information. So in the early modern era, came up with encyclopedias in India. We developed all these bibliographic tools to support our management of information in a whole universal system. It was a societal way of dealing with the increase in knowledge and managing all the different emerging disciplines and bodies of knowledge. And so, you know, we're at a very early stage of figuring out as a culture, you know, individually, yes, it requires great discipline to sort of resist being pulled in all 24/7. In terms of time, but also culturally, you know, what are reasonable expectations that we have in terms of the appropriate integration of technology into our households, into our automobiles, into our workplaces, into our stations.
So I would just say from a relationship, again, psychology relationship perspective, relationships have to be invested. And if I have a student or someone in my office and I say I can't, you know, and the phone rings or it goes off, and I say, excuse me, I've broken the relationship in the moment. So I have, and that's what I'm concerned about, is we are breaking relationships constantly because we're allowing our technology to drive our behavior instead of letting us use technology to shape what we want to do. And so for me, there's gets to be a point of, years ago, my students, I have them, do we have free will or not? And my students say, yes, we have free will, but we don't use it very well. And I would say that is an issue with technology, is we have free will in how we use it, but we don't use that free will very well or very thoughtfully, because we're somehow just primed to answer the buzzer or the bell or whatever thing is going off. So there's a sense of unknown about that, and I think that's the rationality of it, is the reason why we need to control it and not allow it to control us, because it does break relationships in the moment.
I think we have time for one more. Anybody else?
Yeah.
I'm not sure if this is a question, but as I was listening tonight, what kept popping in my mind's eye historically is that, you know, I can imagine this same conversation going on as the printing press was shooting out Martin Luther's essays for the first time and shooting out Bibles in people's native languages. And I could, I can see, you know, someone from the Vatican standing in the front room saying, oh no, average people can't, you know, understand God's word. You know, what are we going to do? God. Anyways, that's my comment. I don't know. If you want to comment, it'd be great.
Is this a qualitative different technology? Is it qualitatively different or quantitative?
I mean, I think that there's a similarity there, certainly. You know, new technology, new access to information, broader access to information, more efficient and affordable. But
ASI's information.
Yeah. Creation of genres, new ways of communicating. But we're talking about a level of magnitude. I mean, printing was big, and it's, you know, it spread pretty quickly the first 50 years. But what you've seen in terms of within the last 25 years, we're talking about some major, you know, wide, broad, global adaptations of the internet and mobile devices and social media. That scale's huge.
It's happened so quickly that much quicker than the sort of proliferation of printing that it sort of outstrips the wisdom. Need to sort of, how are we going to deal with it? That's what we don't know.
Just to finish, you know, I love this quote by Ben Franklin, never confuse motion with action. The corollary might be never confuse fact for knowledge. And so we have a proliferation of facts and information. And as a professor, how do I get students to understand the difference between information and knowledge? How do I get students to understand knowledge and wisdom? And most of what's on the internet is fact. And so that's that deep, thoughtful interaction with it to create those knowledge structures and then know what to do with them.
Actually, what I'm worried about is all that
non-fact. Yeah. Right. That information. That's not. Yeah. Exactly. But how do we work to warrant what is of value when there's so much there?
Well, I think that if there's any other questions, you could probably come forward and ask any of our panelists afterwards. But let's thank them one more time.